vale.
Thank you.
coming?
Perfect. I just, I got the email that I'll meet you here, and I haven't seen you.
Well, good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
We're glad that you are here. We are glad that God has given us this day together in this very special way. We'll have a word of greeting on behalf of our church from one of our very active members, someone who many of you will know, Representative Helen Giddings. She will come and bring a greeting on behalf of some of you.
Thank you very much, Pastor, and good morning to all of you, to our senior pastor, Pastor Masters, and to my colleague, Representative Eric Johnson, who represents the district in which our church resides, to Mayor Rollins, to all of our panelists, to you, distinguished ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to St. Luke on behalf of our membership. You are no stranger to St. Luke, and St. Luke is no stranger to you. We have been taught, and it's a part of our DNA, that we cannot be so heavenly bound here that we are no earthly good. And so we understand that we are a part of this community, that we have a responsibility to help this community be a better place for all of us to live and to work. And St. Luke has always been involved in those issues that involve and concern our community, whether it be hate crime, whether it be education,
Thank you. As we prepare for the opening prayer, let me just share this brief thought that I think reflects sort of why we're here and what we do while we're here. In the fourth chapter of the Gospel of John, there is a situation that has arisen in the community. And a young woman has been charged with adultery. Some of you, maybe you remember that story. And some of the leaders in the community has gathered around and they have stones in their hands. And they are ready to cast these stones at the woman because of what she's done. So what I want to share with you as we prepare for a time of prayer is that as we gather today, we are gathering not to throw stones at each other. Amen. But to have conversation and to hear one another and to try to understand what has happened, why this happened, what can we do about it. Because in some ways, we all, as Jesus pointed out to the leader there, that in some ways, there is blame that can go around in many places. So, let me share then a word of prayer as we begin our time. Let us pray. God, we thank you for the opportunity to gather as your people who are concerned about the issues of the day. We know that there is hurt and there is pain, there is confusion, there is difficulty. But we pray, oh God, that as we gather in the spirit of trying to address those issues in our community that negatively impact our community and each of us. So Lord, help us to be respectful, help us to be understanding, and help us, oh God, to open our eyes and our ears so that we might hear one another. And then be determined to go and do those things that need to be done to correct the problems in our community, to face those issues that are there. And in the process, Lord, may we make our communities a better place, and may we make your kingdom a better place. For we ask this in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
And now we'll have some special greetings from our mayor. Let's give our mayor a hand.
That is of great import to this city, and having you at the helm, we expect great things, and we want to partner with you. This is a great example of that partnership. I will tell you that I will speak to a stump at times, being kind of a loquacious person I am, but I'm a little shy about talking today. This is a tough situation, and when you look at things, you see what has happened, and I'm very careful and thoughtful about what I want to say today. Welcome and thank you for being interested enough. I could kind of talk, and maybe we'll touch on a few things I think the city is doing. I can kind of brag on the fact that crime in the city is down. We're going in the ninth year in a row. You have to go back to the 60s to see some of that, to see some of those facts. It's something we should be proud of. But we're talking about the death of a man today. And I don't care who that man or woman is, when someone dies, there's heartbreak. serious issue, and somehow I feel that we've all failed when someone dies. It doesn't matter if they get shot in the front, shot in the back, shot in the side, they die. And it creates passion. It creates a sense of railing against God at times and saying, why does this happen? But when we have that passion, we must learn to partner it with wisdom. Because otherwise we end up kind of dying for causes as opposed to living for them. And I think that's what we all need to do. We all need to partner our wisdom with that passion to live for the causes that I think we all believe in. And that's kind of what we're doing today. The problem is, wisdom's a tough thing to find. I don't know if I've got much wisdom. I've got a book at home. I love the title of the book. It says, Where Shall Wisdom Be Found? Where shall, in this world, there's not a lot of it. And I sure feel kind of just not worthy to speak wise words on this complicated subject. But then I woke up and say, shoot, I'm the mayor. I got to say something. I just can't let this go. I need to say something. So whenever I'm faced with that, I kind of make it personal. I say, how do I deal with this as opposed to the city dealing with it? We all start with the individual. Well, when I think about it, when I face difficult issues like this, first thing I do is I usually talk with friends. Talk with neighbors, talk with people I respect. And Representative Johnson, you're brilliant for doing this. Because this is the first thing we need to do is talk. We need to talk, we need to listen. Because nobody's got the right answer, but if we string it together, we can create a mosaic of that wisdom that helps us through this. The second, I always try to figure out that there's something underlying the problem I'm dealing with. Whether it's a problem with my wife or my kid or economics, there's something deeper than that. And I try to kind of get to the root problem that we're struggling with. Someone once told me to ask the question why 5 times about something. If you ask why enough, you can kind of start to get to what really is the issue. And as I asked myself the why of this, I really got to the word trust. That at times there's just really a lack of trust that we have with each other. Shoot, I saw for the last couple of weeks, we decided to spray people, or spray the city and spray people, and boy, I'll tell you, people didn't trust. I understand, nobody wants to be sprayed. It's chemicals being sprayed on it, I don't trust that I'm going to be okay. It's a natural thing. We live in a society. And when someone dies, there's a lack of trust. Lack of trust in the police. That's obvious. Okay? Look, the police was the arm of terrible racism in this country for decades. And in the 60s, man, I didn't trust the police. I was white. That's just something to be feared, not trusted. Always due respect, Chief. But somehow, as St. Paul says, we grow up and we put away childish things. We've got to start to realize that times are changing and that we can maybe start to create trust, but we've got to get to the root issue about why aren't we trusting. And that, I think, we're going to talk about today. You know, you see, whether it's Rodney King or just recently Trayvon Martin, you say, this could happen in my backyard, so I need to be ever vigilant. And I've got to make sure that this doesn't happen. So if it does, it even starts to smell like it, I'm going to put my lack of trust meter on high, and I'm going to come out. The third thing I do is somehow I've gotten over the fact that I got pulled over for bad speeding tickets from the police and that they were rude to me. And now as mayor, I'm starting to kind of trust individuals in the police department. I've got a couple of guys that go with me every place. I trust these human beings, and they happen to be policemen. That's helping me trust an organization. But I'll tell you this, the other thing is, I have zero tolerance for breaking the rules and breaking somebody's civil rights. Because we want to trust our police department so much, we put them on a higher standard. And the chief knows this, and every policeman knows this. They've got higher standards. And as long as I'm mayor, if I even smell of that happening, we're going to have real problems. I believe that. I believe that's the right thing to do. Because if we don't do that, we're never going to get to the place we trust each other. If we don't have those high standards. But I also know we live in a real world. And when two people struggle, chances are one of them dies. It's just the facts. And we've got to understand how to keep those people from doing that. The fourth thing for me, as I think through my problems, I go to people. I don't go to institutions. Everybody says, well, City Hall is screwed up, or the county is screwed up, or, you know, Washington is screwed up. There's no such thing as City Hall, or county, or Washington. There are human beings that are either doing good, or they're not doing so good. And as I focus on problems, I look at the heart of individuals and say, do I trust those individuals? Now, I don't know, as I said, every one of our policemen, but I do know Chief Brown. I trust this man. I trust this man for three reasons. One, his performance has been exemplary. Two, on this issue, I'm going to talk about him like he's not here. He has been there, done that, and bought the t-shirt, ladies and gentlemen. If what has happened to him would happen to me, I would roll up in a ball and you wouldn't see me again. He wants to live for a cause, not just go away and just say, life's unfair. So I see that. And the third reason I trust him is he is a learning leader. This is one of the most important things to me for a leader, is someone that takes data, takes a new experience, and improves himself and his organization that he leads. You don't see Chief hiding behind a bunch of things and saying, well, nothing's going to change, it is what it is. Every time there's been a situation where we could have done better, he quickly says, you know what, we can do better, and here's how we're going to optimize the situation. That takes real strength and real courage as an individual to say we can do better. Because frankly, people in your organization don't want you to say that. And you're going to hear about some of that stuff today. This 9/11 call, he's already jumped on it. How can we do better? How can we do better? That's why I trust him. And then lastly, what I do, I make it real personal. I say, what can I do? What should I have done better? Because if you're not 100% right, you're probably 100% wrong. Because you could have done better. Now, I'm not running the police department. But I'll tell you this, I spent a lot of time on what we can do economically in this city. Dictionary says, money makes the world go round. Okay? It's about the money. And when it's easier to make money go in this direction than that direction, you tend to kind of say, well, I'm going to do this. I'm going to take the risk. I may die, but I'm going to take that risk. That's not acceptable. We need to make sure that the economic growth in this city is in every neighborhood. So I'm going to be ever vigilant on knocking homes down. Okay? I am. I want to get rid of these homes and out of the hands of people that let them happen and let them exist for bad reasons. The second thing I want to do is make sure that we have better programs for ex-offenders. We've got to do that in Austin. Okay? We've got too many people with a great life in front of them that have given their, they paid their penance. But the doors are locked to them forever. Somehow we have to power through that issue. We're going to, this is going to be continued. I asked Chief Brown, how many criminals do you, what percent of the criminals are ex-offenders? And he said, probably 75%. Think about that. If we could deal with the ex-offenders and somehow get them to say, look, there's a job here, there's a future here, so much more can happen. We are working in in Washington with job training funds. We're working with Workforce Solutions to get people trained. We've got programs in town. We've got individuals that will hire those individuals. And that's kind of my job as mayor, is to be a matchmaker. I need to do that better. I need to do that faster. And you've got my promise because of this. I'm even more energized today than I was before. So for me, it's all about trust. And trust doesn't happen overnight. It really doesn't. It's something you have to kind of learn and experience and understand and see the history. Because a lot of times trust is just predicting the future based on the past actions. So there's got to be a series of good past actions for somebody to really trust you. I think we're building that culture, but we've got so much more to do. Pastor, I hope that we have, and I pray for the patience for trust, but really the wisdom to know whom to trust as we power through this issue. I'm here to listen to you, and I've got great.
So it is a space that we invite the community to. But
she was a person of great respect and dignity, so we want to conduct ourselves in that spirit. Amen?
Amen.
So we hope you will do that. And we didn't just invite the chief here just to make sure that we had order in the place. No, we are inviting the chief because he has something to say. But well, we're glad that you're here, and we hope that you will honor that. So having said that, I'm going to turn it over to Eric. Let's give Eric a hand for it.
Thank you, Dr. Masters. I appreciate that. First of all, I want to thank all of you for being here on a Saturday morning. I know you all have things to do, but I think this is very important, and I think you all agree, as evidenced by your presence. So thank you for being here, and I want to thank St. Luke and Dr. Masters for opening their doors to us and to the community today. And I especially want to thank Mayor Rawlings for being here on his birthday. I don't know if I'm supposed to admit that. Today is his actual birthday. So we appreciate you being here. We're not going to sing right now, but we appreciate it. At least I'm not going to lead any singing, but I appreciate you being here. And I also want to acknowledge some of the elected officials that I saw come in since Representative Giddings came in. She's been recognized here. She's still here. I don't know if she's still here, but State Representative Helen Giddings was here. I also see, at one point I saw come down, and in this country, there are things going on just of a violent nature all around us. There's obviously an uptick in, you know, shootings generally, mass shootings around the country. People are just taking, you know, taking guns and doing harm to their brothers and sisters. And we're tired. We're tired of it. So we said, you know what? We need to do something. And that something we need to do, we think, is sit down together as family and talk about it. Talk about what's going on and getting informed, that's the key, with knowledge. Because we believe, I think everybody up here believes, that knowledge really is power. And that it's one thing to emote and be emotional about something. Because this is a very emotional topic. I don't want to belittle the emotions that anybody might be feeling. But it's also a topic that is not going to resolve itself by emotion. It's going to resolve itself because people inform themselves, they get the facts, they get the information about what's going on, and then we take matters into our own hands as a community to fix it. So that's what these people up here are for. This is how they got picked. There aren't politicians up here other than, you know, me moderating, because we want to get the information from the people who have it. So I'm going to tell you who these people are up here and what their expertise is. We're going to ask them a couple of questions, we being, you know, prepared some questions for the panel that we think will get the conversation started, and then we're going to turn it over to you to ask the questions that you want to ask. And what we ask you to do is one of two things. Either, if you don't want to stand up and you may be shy, you can fill out an index card, submit your question, and we'll ask it for you. Or if you want to take to the microphone in the back, you can go to the back and ask your question. It's your choice. But all we ask is that you be respectful of these people's time, and that you be respectful of where we are, because we're guests here. This is not my church, not my house. This is the Lord's house and Dr. Masters' facility. So please be respectful of that, okay? That's all we ask. So with that being said, let me get the bios that I have for these esteemed panelists and tell you a little bit about them. I'm going to read through their bios very quickly, and then we're going to get to the question and answer period. So our first panelist that we have is our police chief, David Brown. Our police chief is a 28-year veteran of the Dallas Police Department, and as chief of police, he commands a department that comprises over 4,200 employees, 3,600 of them being sworn officers, and he oversees an annual operating budget of $410 million. Chief Brown holds a Bachelor of Science degree in Business Administration and a Master of Business Administration degree in Strategic Leadership. Chief Brown is also a graduate of the Federal Bureau of Investigation National Academy, the FBI National Executive Institute, the Senior Management Institute for Police, the National Counterterrorism Seminar in Tel Aviv, Israel, and the United States Secret Service Dignitary Protection Seminar in Washington, D.C. He holds Master Peace Officer and Police Instructor certifications from the state of Texas. So let's give a warm round of applause for our people. We also have today with us a special guest, someone I've known for a long time, City Attorney Thomas Perkins. Tom Perkins has served as the City Attorney of Dallas since 2005. And prior to his appointment as City Attorney, he was the first Assistant City Attorney and Chief of Litigation. As the City Attorney, Tom supervises the staff of approximately 100 attorneys. The City Attorney's Office is responsible for representing the city in all litigation matters, preparing all city contracts and ordinances, and advising the City Council, its members, and all city departments. Mr. Perkins has taught as an adjunct professor at SMU School of Law and is currently a member of the Federal Court Advisory Committee of the Northern District of Texas and Dallas CASA's Committee of 30. Mr. Perkins is a graduate of Harvard University and Loyola University Law School. He's been married for 26 years to one of my good friends, Denise Bunkley, and is the father of two sons. So let's give a round of applause for our city attorney. We also have with us today business owner James Mitchell. James Mitchell is the owner and CEO of SMP Enterprises. His company serves the HR consulting, real estate development, and hospitality markets. He served on the board of directors for the TI Foundation, Texas Instruments Foundation, the MIT Industrial Advisory Board on Minority Education, the Executive Board of the Graduate Engineering Minority Consortium, the Dallas Urban League, the Dallas Historical Society, the YMCA of Dallas, countless other organizations, including the Dallas Black Chamber of Commerce, and he's the past chairman of the Dallas County WorkSource Board. He's a graduate of Prairie View A&M University, and he currently serves on both the Capital Campaign Steering Committee for Prairie View and the President's Advisory Council. He's a member of Concord Missionary Baptist Church, where he chaired the Business and Professional Ministry. Mr. Mitchell is married to Vicki Mitchell, and they have two children and two grandchildren. So let's give a warm round of applause for James Mitchell. We also have with us today Anna Hill, who is the president of the Dolphin Heights Neighborhood Association and Crime Watch. Ms. Hill is a lifelong resident of Dallas. She attended St. Peter's Academy, Booker T. Washington High School, James Madison High School, and received her GED from SMU. She attended the National School of Medical Technology and graduated as a registered phlebotomist. She is a state registered nurse's assistant and home health aide, and in March 1970, she went to work at Baylor University Medical Center as a nurse aide before receiving several promotions, and spent 30 years at Baylor and recently retired to become a full-time caregiver to her mother. So with the guidance of the Dallas Leadership Foundation, she helped organize and create the Dolphin Heights Neighborhood and Crime Watch Association. She now serves as the president of that organization. So let's give a warm round of applause. Last but not least, and this is her real name, folks, we have Miss Beautiful Dillard, who is a student at Pinkston High School in West Dallas. And she's looking forward to starting school on Monday. And her favorite subject in school is algebra. She's an active member of the Young Life West Dallas organization, and her interests include singing and dancing. She comes from a large family, is the fifth of nine children. And after graduating from Pinkston, which we know she will do, she hopes to earn a degree in education from Texas A&M Commerce so that she can become a professional educator. So let's give a round of applause for her. We have two questions for each panel. We're just going to go through round one with a question, then a second round with a question, and then we're going to turn it open to the public to ask any questions they'd like. So this is just to kind of get us warmed up. So our first question is directed at our police chief, David Brown. And that question is, can you explain your recently announced new policy directives and what you hope these new policy directives will accomplish?
Thank you and good morning to everyone. I'm going to explain those. And I'm not going to stand up because people say you look taller on TV. And I was taller before I took this job. So if you don't mind, I'll sit and dialogue with you. The policy changes came from a really introspective look at what we were doing as the Dallas Police Department and how we could improve. And I look back over 10 years of data to come to the point of announcing these policy changes. Of course, irrelevant of what happens on a single incident, there's a story that can be told if you look back at history and say, okay, did we do all we can do or could do to mitigate these circumstances? And one of the key policy announcements of the eight was a foot chase policy. There is a best practice across the country when officers are chasing people on foot. As of course, you know, this incident involved a foot chase. Three officers decided to try to chase four people from a house. And so if you look at 10 years of data, most of our shootings, or at least many of our shootings, involve foot chases. And the question I have is, are we chasing people in the safest manner to protect both officers and citizens? And so that's one of the things that I wanted to make sure we at least acknowledged we can be better at chasing people to protect officers first and citizens second. Of course, I'm a fourth generation Dallasite. My great-grandparents lived in Southern Dallas. My grandparents lived in Southern Dallas. And my parents, my mother still lives in Southern Dallas, not far from Dixon Circle. And so I've heard over my entire life some of the things that Southern Dallas has asked the police department to do to build trust. And that's another thing I looked at when I announced these changes. And one thing I've heard my entire life is that we want FBI review of shootings. We want an independent look at what the investigation is, an independent look at the facts, and we want someone other than the police investigators talking about what the officer did, right, wrong, or, you know, whatever the issues are. And so that's another one of the policy changes that I've announced of the eight, is that the police department will reach out, call the FBI, present them the facts, and then, of course, the FBI decides what cases they take. Of course, if you don't know this, we have a local FBI division. They're divided amongst all the major cities. And so there's a local FBI special agent in charge, and they have a civil rights division. And what normally happens is that when we conclude an investigation, the FBI will decide whether or not they want to look at the investigation. So this policy preempts that, because an investigation could take several weeks. Presentation to the grand jury, which is the process of all shootings that involve a death, could take 6 months. And we just don't have that kind of time, based on perceptions, especially on something that's controversial. So to get out in front of the time delay for the FBI to even decide to take a look, this policy really preempts that process. And it's one of the things I've heard called for. And really, internally, it's not well received by officers to have an outside look at something they've done. But we're public servants. We work for the public. We don't work for ourselves. And so I think it's much more important to be transparent. If you're right, no matter who looks at it, it'll be right, has been my response. And if you made a mistake, the FBI ought to look at it. So that's one of the things that's part of the announcements. Another is, and we already do some of this, is that we have tasers, right? So we have loopholes in our taser policy. And let me just say this first and foremost about tasers. There are some cities in this country who want to ban tasers, of course. And then when you have something controversial where you think tasers might have saved a life, you have advocates for tasers. So taser is not the end-all, be-all solution to police shootings, but it is a tool. It's a tool that can mitigate your having to use deadly force. Of course, you never bring a taser to a gunfight, right? Never bring a taser to a gunfight, because you will lose every time. So I don't want to, and let's talk about this incident and taser. So the officers got this call. They're looking in the house. They think someone's kidnapped and about to be killed. They're looking inside. They see guns on the table. And then they see four young men, black gentlemen, grab the gun. One of them grab the gun and run out. And they don't know which one has a gun. So the officers are chasing, trying to catch four people. Officer Rowland get behind Mr. Harper, who is deceased, who was shot and killed by
Officer Bowden, and he never eliminates the possibility that, he's the person that grabbed that gun off a table. So if he were the person that grabbed the gun, a taser wouldn't be the solution. You don't pull a taser out, and then Mr. Harper pulls a gun out, and you tell him to wait till you can put your taser down and grab your gun. So during the whole incident, the officer, according to his statements to us, believed Mr. Harper might have had a gun. So that's why I say, you know, taser can't be the solution in every case, but it's a tool that can be used in the appropriate circumstances. And so we have a loophole in our policy of officers carrying a taser that didn't require every officer to be trained in taser usage. There's a certification that you need in order to carry a taser. And so this policy requires every officer in the department to be trained in taser, while before it was optional. So that's that change. Let's see what else we have here. One of the things I've also heard my entire life in Dallas is that the police, and this is not necessarily associated with the shooting, but more about trust, the mayor mentioned. And I've heard this from Hispanic community, African American community, is police officers search our cars without cause. They get us out of the car, put us on the ground, and they don't have a legal reason to search our cars. And we get treated differently. This is more the racial profiling complaint we get. Not so much that they stopped me because I'm black or Hispanic, is that when they did stop me, they treated me differently by getting me out of the car, treating me like a criminal without legal reason. And so our consent to search policy allowed the officer to use a lot of discretion to do that. And one of the things that I announced along with the other eight policy changes is that would require officers to get written consent for non-consensual searches. And so the Fourth Amendment, of course, gives us our search and seizure rules, the Fourth Amendment of the Constitution. And if you don't have probable cause, in other words, someone's not doing something illegal, there are seven exceptions. So if I smell someone smoking marijuana, that's an exception to getting a warrant, right? If I see something illegal, if I see a dead body in the back seat, you don't want us to, you know, so we can search your car. But if you're not doing anything illegal, if we don't have other probable cause, officers have the discretion to search by just asking you verbally, which is the weakest form of a search. Because when you get to court, the person's going to say, if you have Shaft's Big Score in that car, and all you have is verbal consent, the person's going to get off because he's going to say, I didn't give you verbal consent, and you're going to say, yes, you did. So it's going to be a he said, she said. So irregardless of the trust issue for an officer, it's a bad police practice to use verbal consent to search a car. So given all that, if you can build trust and have a better case on top of it through a policy, why not do it? And so I'm requiring through this announcement written consent that's recorded on video for every verbal consent circumstance. First of all, it proves up the he said, she said, did you or didn't you? It records if the officer intimidated the person to give verbal consent, which is a possibility. So all of our squad cars have a video recorder. So if an officer is wanting verbal consent, he has to walk that person within video view and audio view, because all our officers are mic'd up, if you didn't know that. We have a mic that's recording everything they're saying when they stop someone on traffic, and video recording everything they're doing. So walk the person back is what the policy is. Get them to sign that they agree to allow you to search their car, and it's recorded and stored as evidence if we end up finding a dead body in the trunk that you're transporting through our city. We have a strong case then to convict you of murder, rather than you saying, I never gave verbal consent, and we have no proof of it. The last thing I'll mention before I turn it over is one of the policy changes is not necessarily something for officers to do or not do. it's an historical perspective of Dallas's relationship through research with its citizens. In 1988, congressional hearings came to Dallas because of police shootings and gave a scathing report on our relationship with the community. Next year will be the 25-year anniversary of that congressional hearing. A whole generation of cops don't know anything about the congressional hearings. Right? Know anything about it. The city of Seattle just went into a consent decree because of police shooting, which means the Justice Department comes in and basically takes over the department because there's issues with their practices. We can learn from our own history, and we can learn from present day issues, from organizational failures, of what are the best things to avoid, what are the best policies to do, what are the best practices in relation to city shootings. So we want to have a review of all of that historical perspective and present day perspective so that we can learn and so that we can really teach our officers what to do, what not to do, and the why to all of this, which is very important. And before I turn it over to State Representative Johnson, let me just recount the shooting real quickly. Several days before this shooting, Mr. Johnson and Mr. Harper, who is the deceased, Mr. Harper is the deceased, the person who shot and killed, got into a very violent fight over Mr. Johnson dating one of the girls that one of his friends liked, and Mr. Johnson selling Mr. Harper $4,000 of fake drugs. Okay? So he owed Mr. Johnson, owed Mr. Harper $4,000. So Mr. Harper beat him to the point where the blood vessels in Mr. Johnson's eyes burst, beat him and choked him. Mr. Johnson was so angry about that encounter, he calls 911 to report that someone was being kidnapped and about to be killed at the dope house Mr. Harper was running as a drug dealer, so he can get back and get him arrested. And so our officers get this call, and they race code 3, lights and sirens to this call, thinking they're needing to save someone's life when it's bogus all along. And Mr. Johnson makes this call and then immediately goes to a Metro PCS to change his phone number. So he switches phones, gets a new phone number. Someone else is in the store in line and gets assigned that phone number. So when we're calling back to try to get more information about the call, the person answering has no knowledge about ever calling 911. I just got this phone. I don't know what you're talking about. But there's video in Metro PCS. We do a GPS. We figure out where the call came from and figure go inside and get the store video and see Mr. Johnson coming in to change the phone. So officers Rowden and two of his partners rush to get to the house and immediately see the scurrying inside through the cracks in the door and through the windows, and officers are taking out the window unit, the air conditioning unit, and trying to get into the house to what they think is to protect someone. And all four individuals inside begin running. And one person grabs a gun, like I mentioned earlier. Then there's a shotgun in there. There's several other guns in there. There's crack cocaine in there, PCP, Xanax, hydrocodone. I mean, it's a full-fledged drug house. Full-fledged drug house. And so the four gentlemen run in different directions. Our three officers pursue all four. One of the officers catches someone immediately in the front yard. He's the guy I would have chased, the slow, fat one. That's who I would have chased. But that's who's called first. So he stays with that prisoner. Officer Rowden chases Mr. Harper. Mr. Harper, 6'10", 273 pounds. No body fat. Former quarterback at Lincoln. So he chases Mr. Harper. Officer Rowden's out, weighed by about 50 pounds. And so they jump three fences, and they struggle at each encounter as the fences, you know, you slow down and jump a fence, so that's when you can grab somebody, get in the fight. Rowden loses the first fight, he loses the second fight. The third fight is actually in a horse barn, a working horse barn. And they're inside on hay and horse manure fighting. Slipping and fighting in horse manure and hay. And Harper is winning the fight at every chance. And so it's 100 degrees, more than 100 degrees that day. And Rowland is exhausted. And Harper shows no sign of tiring. And at some of the last movements, according to Harper, some of the last kind of struggles was Harper decides, I'm going to try to handcuff him before I get too exhausted. So he pulls his handcuffs out, tries to straddle Mr. Harper, tries to get on top of him and hold him down and pull his arm behind him. And Mr. Harper grabs the handcuffs like they're a toy and just tosses them. He snatches them out of the officer's hand and just tosses them. Mr. Harper has drug money in his front pocket and his cell phone. And he's constantly reaching, doing his whole encounter to make sure the money isn't lost out of his pocket, we think now. For Officer Rowland, his perspective is he's reaching for that gun. I think somebody, he's one of the guys that might have grabbed a gun. He's constantly reaching for the gun, but that's not the case. And at one point before the shooting happens, Mr. Harper reaches one more time into his pocket to secure the money. And Officer Rowland believes he's now going for that perceived gun, grabs Mr. Harper's hand and pins it to his pocket, and hanging on for dear life. And Mr. Harper is much stronger than him the whole time, so he pulls away, and that's when Officer Rowland believes, I'm exhausted, I can't beat this guy, I slipped into this horse manure in this hay, and I could lose my footing. And people say, well, he didn't have a gun. There wasn't a gun there. There was a gun there. The officer's gun. And we got to win a fight. You lose a fight, you lose your gun. You lose your gun, you lose your life. That's the reality of policing in American cities in this country. And so Officer Rowland, now all this is his version, pulls his gun, fires his weapon three times, about as far away as the state representative is from me. That's far away. And how we know that is through the autopsy ballistics. When you're close, there's gunpowder residue on you. When you're far away, there's less gunpowder residue on you. There was gunpowder residue on Mr. Harper to indicate that they were fairly close, arm's length apart. And of course, we immediately called a press conference within an hour and a half. I actually was on vacation, about to go to the pool one last time with my little girl, when I got the call that we had to shoot in Dixon Circle. And knowing Dixon Circle, I immediately said, I need to come in to work. And had the facts as quickly as we've ever gotten facts on the police shooting. And did a press conference, announced everything that happened and what we do. And that evening, we called the FBI Civil Rights Division and said, hey, this is what we have. If you want to come in, look, you're welcome. But we recounted everything we knew to the FBI Civil Rights Division that evening. And I'll turn it over to you, Mr. State Representative Johnson. Thank you so much for inviting me as well.
Okay, so we know a lot of the violence that we see in our community is drug related, and what a question we get a lot is, and I'm going to direct this question to our city attorney, is could you talk to us about what's involved in shutting down a known drug house? A lot of people ask the question, well, if the police or we all know in these communities where the drug houses are, how can we still have drug houses? So what we want to know is, what is the process of getting a known drug house shut down? How long does it take? What's involved, and whether people can report these houses or this type of activity anonymously. So there's a mic we want to let y'all get you this, that one.
There are a couple of tools that we use at the city attorney's office, working very closely with the Dallas Police Department and the code department to address issues associated with drug houses. One is that we have the ability to declare a property a nuisance property and close that property down, property that we spent an awful lot of time on, an apartment complex on Hatcher Street, Summer Breeze Apartments, that have been a real problem for this neighborhood for a very long time. A lot of open and vacant structures where people were hanging out, either selling drugs, doing drugs, or breaking into their neighborhood homes from this property. We went to court, it took a while, but we were able to convince the court that this is a property that cannot be salvaged, needs to be demolished, and I think at this point about 90% of that structure, of that apartment complex, over 200-300 units, is now gone. So that's another tool, but again, we've got to go to court, we've got to go to case, and if that takes some time, it takes work with the police department to accomplish that. The other tool that we have is open and vacant structures or substandard structures. Over the last 5 years, we've demolished 800 structures in the city of Dallas that have been open and vacant and are either substandard or nuisance properties. This is really one of the most important things that I do as a city attorney. It is a real priority for the Dallas City Council. It's a real priority for the mayor of Dallas that we really focus on ridding our neighborhoods of these open and vacant substandard structures. As a matter of fact, the mayor and the council have committed additional resources and monies that we're going to demolish another 250 of those structures over the next year with the mayor's leadership and with the funding provided by the Dallas City Council. That's priority number one for me and for my office, is to rid our neighborhoods of those kind of structures. Because what happens is those open and vacant structures become sources for bad guys to hang out, do drugs, and attack their neighbors. And they're just a real problem for our neighborhoods if we continue to allow these structures to exist. So I hope that you will continue to see the benefits of the work that we're doing with DPD. As I said, it is one of my top priorities and a top priority for the Dallas City Council and for Mayor Rawlings that we rid our neighborhoods of those structures, and that's a commitment that you have for my office and for the city of Dallas.
Thank you very much, Attorney Perkins. This next question is for Mr. Mitchell. Mr. Mitchell operates a business in South Dallas on Martin Luther King, and so the question we have that we want to ask you is, what's the impact of violent crime, drug-related activity on your business, or businesses that are similar to your business located in the same community, and why should the rest of us who aren't business owners care about that? Why is that important?
Well, the mayor has just mentioned or talked about economic growth, which has a major impact on what happens in a community. And in concert with what Tom just said, city manager just said, economic development and growth in a community has a lot to do with, like you said, in your house, of course, curb appeal. Now, if you have this stigma of high crime, obviously, people are not going to come and buy your wares, if you would. If you have the bad curb appeal, for example, with we have an ordinance that when you turn on the Martin Luther King off the 175, you are greeted by a guy who is violating that ordinance. Now, representing the Homeowners Association over there, which I'm a part of also, it is really important for us to get rid of those undesirables, if you would. And unfortunately, on Martin Luther King, we have a knack. And it's basically the thing that Tom just talked about. That is, we've got a car wash. I don't know if you guys are familiar with it. But there's a car wash where that draws off undesirables. I happen to talk to a lot of the people in the community who might be considered undesirable. Some of them are not, they're just unfortunate. But these folk, when I ask them, how'd you get to this community? Their response generally is, well, I was in jail, and my homeboy, who's in jail with me, told me when I get out of jail to meet him over at Starlight. As a result, we got all of these people being drawn to this one area. Now, our code enforcement people are working their buns off, and by the way, they told me to tell the mayor that they're understaffed. And that's true. And our officers, police officers, are getting more involved. We've got people like the city attorney's office who are working very hard to close down these places where these people might sleep or whatever. And I am told by a lot of these people, like from the city attorney's office, that part of the problem has to do with laws that are controlled by the state that Eric and Hillen can help with. So there's a ton of ways that that we are impacted negatively from a business perspective, but I'm gonna give you this background on why I'm involved. When I retired from Texas Instruments after about 30 plus years, one of the things that I decided I'd do was to give back to the community and to try to rebuild a part of my community, because I feel like that's an obligation that I've got. In doing that, I, along with a couple of other fellows, decided that we were going to make Martin Luther King Quarter something that could be proud of. We've done some good things there, but there's a lot of things to be done. And as long as we have people who are not bringing commerce to the community, but running commerce away from the community, we will never succeed. So that's something that we just gotta make happen. I'm gonna say this publicly, we have got to get rid of the car wash or do something to change the fact that even though we might have we might have 100 cameras over there and all of that, we still got people over there dealing drugs. So we got to have another industry in our community, Dixon Circle included, other than drugs. The only industry that we've got in our community over there, think about this, the only industry is drugs. We got to get rid of that. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mitchell. Our next question is for Neighbor Association President Anna Hill. What we'd like to hear you tell us is, how has the relationship, going back to what the mayor talked about in his welcome, about the trust between the community and the police, how has the relationship between the community and the police department changed since you lived in the neighborhood? Is the relationship better, worse, the same as it was 10, 20, 30 years ago, however far back you can remember? How are we doing in terms of where we are now to where we used to be with regard to the relationship between the police and the residents that they are protecting?
This is a twofold question. Are you speaking specifically of Dauphin Heights and the police, or are you speaking in general, like from the 60s up to now?
You can speak to Dolphin Heights, and then if you have time, you can generalize it, that would be fine.
Okay. I moved into what we now call Dolphin Heights Neighborhood Association in the middle 80s. And when I moved into that area, it was when I moved into this neighborhood, it was an African-American neighborhood with children and grandparents and parents. There was not much crime in the area at that time. But as the in the middle 80s, and when I moved into that area, it was when I moved into this neighborhood, it was an African-American neighborhood with children and grandparents and parents. There was not much crime in the area at that time. But as the older generation died out, mm-hmm. the younger generation neglected the property.
That's right.
They moved to DeSoto, Cedar Hill, wherever, and this property was neglected in the area that I moved to. So I watched drugs come into this neighborhood, take over a lot of the houses. We had slumlords that rented to drug dealers. I watched drug dealers pay the slumlords. So I'm looking at all of this right in front of where I live. So I took like a yellow tablet like this, a pen, and I would sit on the porch and I would start writing. And I started calling the police with very little trust, because I had called police. This is in the 80s. I would say I wanted to remain anonymous. I'm looking at somebody doing drugs. Could you send the police to that place? Instead of them going where the drugs were, they came straight to my front door. So this made me distrust calling the police. This all started in the 80s. I didn't give up. I just started calling 911, and I got to be so popular with 911. I have some policemen that's been on the force a long time that's come back and told me, I remember you when you were the only one in Dolphin Heights calling the police department. So now in 2004, my husband passed in 92. The drugs were rampant. Police were getting a little bit better because I started reporting police on the 911 system. In 2004, we organized a crime watch group. And I had made it my purpose, since they had elected me to be the president, I made a promise to myself and that neighborhood. I'm going to work with the police department, the city of Dallas, whoever's in the mayor's office, the city council. And I can truthfully say, when you be persistent and you really care about where you live and you step up, you stand up, go to Chief Brown, hey Chief Brown, they doing so and so, can you do something about it? Mayor Rollins, I need a contact. You have to get up and go. And it's no such thing as you cannot trust Chief Brown, Mayor, anyone else, city attorneys. You just have to open your heart, you trust in God, and you
Amen, sister.
Hold people accountable. Mm-hmm. And from all this experience, that was in 2004, and I look at Chief Brown, Mr. Perkins, Mayor Rollins, I don't know how to say Mr. Hey, Tom, how you doing? You know, can you come help me get rid of this house? But when you get out and you start talking and you honest about what you're doing in your neighborhood,
all of these people sitting in here, including the residents, everybody is going to pitch in. Somebody's going to call the police. And trust in the police department. Who else can you trust outside of the police department and government? So, no, I support the police and everything that they do. I don't have too much input on Mr. Harper. I will say I knew Mr. Harper. I have friends in Dixon Circle. To be honest about it, I've reported that drug house. Okay, you have to have trust. I did that. Now, I'm saying what I did. No policeman is going to say, telling anybody, Miss Hill, turn that drug house in. I believe in what we stand up for, and I think all of us do. You have to trust the police department. You have to work with your code and city people. You have to do all this stuff. You can't do it by yourself. I'm sorry Mr. Harper's dead, but you have to look at what Mr. Harper was doing. If we get into a fight, I don't know about that. You know what I'm saying? When you're fighting for your life, it could go either way. So I don't have too much comments on that issue.
Well, thank you, Ms. Hill, for that. It means an honor.
Doing drugs. Could you send the police to that place? Instead of them going where the drugs were, they came straight to my front door. So this made me distrust calling the police. This all started in the 80s. I didn't give up. I just started calling 911. And I got to be so popular with 911. I have some policemen that's been on the force a long time that's come back and told me, I remember you when you were the only one in Dauphin Heights calling the police department. So now in 2004, my husband passed in 92. The drugs were rampant. Police were getting a little bit better because I started reporting police on the 911 system. In 2004, we organized a crime watch group. And I had made it my purpose, since they had nominated and elected me to be president, I made a promise to myself in that neighborhood. I'm going to work with the police department, the city of Dallas, whoever's in the mayor's office, the city council. And I can truthfully say, when you be persistent, and you really care about where you live, and you step up, you stand up, go, Chief Fran, they doing so-and-so, can you do something about it? Mayor Romans, I need a contact. You have to get up and go. And it's no such thing as you cannot trust Chief Brown, Mayor, anyone else, city attorneys. You just have to open your heart. You trust in God, and you hold people accountable. And from all this experience, that was in 2004, and I look at Chief Brown, Mr. Perkins, Mayor Rollins. I don't know how to say Mr. Hey, Tom, how you doing? You know, can you come help me get rid of this house? But when you get out and you start talking, and honest about what you're doing in your neighborhood, all of these people sitting in here, including the residents, everybody is going to pitch in. Somebody's going to call the police. And trust in the police department. Who else can you trust outside of the police department and government? So, no, I support the police and everything that they do. I don't have too much input on Mr. Harper. I will say, I knew Mr. Harper. I have friends in Dixon Circle. To be honest about it, I've reported that drug house. Okay, you have to have trust. I did that. Now, I'm saying what I did. No policeman is going to say, telling anybody, Miss Hill, turn that drug house in. I believe in what we stand up for. And I think all of us do. You have to trust the police department. You have to work with your code and city people. You have to do all this stuff. You can't do it by yourself. I'm sorry Mr. Harper's dead, but you have to look at what Mr. Harper was doing. If we get into a fight, I don't know about that. But you know what I'm saying? When you're fighting for your life, it could go either way. So I don't have too much comments on that issue.
Thank you, Ms. Hill, for that, for being so honest. Kind of to piggyback on that, we have beautiful Dillard here. She's here to represent the youth perspective. And the question that we want to ask her is, and we please be honest with us, we're trying to get information and people can make up their own minds. Everyone's intelligent here. But what we want to know is from the, we're not as young anymore as you are. So we want to know, honestly, how do the youth of today, your friends, view the police in your neighborhood, and how do you view the drug dealers in your neighborhood? And just what is your perception of each group? What's your relationship to each group, honestly?
The kids in my neighborhood view the police as not friendly, as a threat, aggressive. That's how most of them view the police. But I view the police as protective. They're here to protect us, and if it wasn't for them, the world would be very chaotic. Really would. And I view drug dealers as, they're bad. They're no use. What are they for? But most kids glorify them to be high, as in when they see them, they see money, green. Like, I need that. I need to do that. But really, they need to be out of the neighborhood.
Thank you. We have one more question for each, and we're going to go quickly this time. We want to get to you all's questions, but we want to get everybody kind of in the frame of mind. We're thinking about this the right way. So, Chief Brown, back to you. Can you tell us, and we'll pass the mic that I'm down while I'm asking this. Can you tell us what kind of training your officers receive on the use of deadly force? And if you do training, how do you assess whether or not an officer has actually learned anything? Have they mastered that training? In other words, I've worked in organizations before where they make people undergo training, but then they don't do any follow-up to see if you actually learned what you were trained on. I've also been in organizations where they train you, then they test you to see if you actually have learned something. So how does the police department handle training their officers on using deadly force?
Okay, so I mentioned in 1988, the congressional hearings came to Dallas. Before that congressional hearing, the department did not have a deadly force policy. Out of that hearing, that was one of the more scathing criticisms of the department not having a deadly force policy. And the recommendation was, the first thing we needed to do is create a deadly force policy. So since 1988, we developed a deadly force policy. In the state of Texas, to be a peace officer, to be a police officer, you have to go through required training to keep your license. 40 hours of training in a 24-hour cycle it really basically goes over all the things that's required to be a police officer, which includes our deadly force policy, things, tactics to use your weapon. Our training for shooting scenarios is called reality-based training. So if you come to our police academy, veteran officers have to go through a simulator. It's a screen, and they use technology to create these scenarios of people running from you, people in a crowd with a gun. Every scenario you could think of is part of the ongoing training of all of our veteran officers in order to keep their peace officer license. It is the most advanced training that's out there in American law enforcement, this reality-based training where you actually see the scenario on a screen more than a video game. You have a simulated gun in your hand that when you take action, you see the action on the screen and you can critique it. Our staff critiques what they did when they did it and matches their action to whether or not that will be consistent with our policy. And that's our training at this point. There's things that we do also through all of our promotional processes for our supervision that makes us look at our policy and score your responses. So all of our supervision that's promoted goes over this along with their 40-hour training in a 24-hour cycle as a requirement by the state. So we have some of the more advanced training. Some of the things I also do is bring in kind of a kitchen cabinet of community leaders to look at our training curriculum, to offer input. We've done that with LULAC, we've done that with NAACP, we've done that with the SCLC, and we're open to do that with any community group, neighborhood group, to come in and look at our curriculum and offer us feedback. We do that on an ongoing basis. We try to be transparent with our policies, and so anyone can look at what we require. And just real quickly before I close, our deadly force policy basically includes an escalation of force, so verbal commands, the baton, the taser, wrist locks, some physical things we do, forearm tactics, similar to a little bit of judo type of tactics to disable people. And then, of course, we require you to qualify with your pistol each year at a high level score in order to be able to carry a pistol so we can be accurate with our firearm if we have to use it. So our policy basically requires you to use every reasonable alternative before using your firearm. We cannot use our firearms for any other reason other than to protect the officer's life and a citizen's life, period. There's no other. So for example, shooting someone in the back, running away, you will be fired and indicted in this county as a police officer. It's not consistent with our policy. It's not consistent with state law. Our policy requires us to use every reasonable alternative to protect the officer's life and to protect the citizen's life, only to protect life, only.
Thank you very much, Chief Brown. Next question for Attorney Perkins. What is the law regarding open records requests in the wake of a police shooting, and what accounts for the different treatment of the same types of material, like 911 tapes, dash cam videos, from case to case? So, for example, why in one case will the police department make certain things public and seemingly without even being asked, and in other cases, refuse to release this information?
The state has a Public Information Act that ensures that the public has a right to know what we do, to see the documents that we have, and any other information that's in possession of city government or city officials. However, there is an exception to that law called the law enforcement exception. And what that does is, to the extent that the police chief or DPD or the district attorney's office, it's at certain stages of a criminal investigation, it's not appropriate to release certain information. It can jeopardize the abilities to successfully prosecute a case. It can endanger witnesses. There are any number of factors that the police department has to weigh when it balances how much information do we release and when, and how do we make sure that we protect the integrity of a criminal investigation and ensure the success of a criminal investigation. I think the Dallas Police Department has a pretty aggressive program of getting information out as quickly as possible, but they have to balance when do we release that information and how much do we release that information and still protect the integrity of their prosecution and the people involved in an incident.
Thank you very much. Mr. Mitchell, what's your experience, your direct experience in dealing with law enforcement with respect to criminal activity and enforcing code violations in your area? I mean, your personal experience dealing with law enforcement in your area.
Actually, very positive from a standpoint of being responsive from
particularly to address the police officer part. The guys are very responsive, and attending meetings that we ask them to attend. Sometimes they don't have the right answers because a lot of them are good friends of mine, and my question always is, if I know where the drug houses are, how come you don't know? So that's, and I am told by a lot of them is that we do know, but we can't just go in and shut them down for whatever reason. So that's really not satisfactory to me, and it's not to them also, but I understand that there are some restraints that they have to look at. So from a code enforcement standpoint, this is a really good time for code enforcement, for the business owners who are in the fair park area, because the fair is about to come. And guess what? When the fair is about to come, code enforcement, the city of Dallas shows up and everything gets cleaned up. Now what I say to you is, why don't we do this year round? So from that perspective, again, and I don't just run around and complain. I talk to people who are responsible and the people who are doing the work. I'm going to do this again. Mayor, they say they need some more code enforcement. So I hope that.
That was fantastic. Thank you very much. Ms. Hill, what are you and the folks in your community doing specifically to make your community safer that you think is actually working?
Communication. We have monthly neighborhood meetings. We have a policeman. We have a code person that's present. And we discuss the things that need to be done in our area. I'm not the only one that does all the reporting. The residents have begun to trust code enforcement, the police. They see things, they call me, but they call 911 first, and then they call to let me know that they call 911 and ask me to call too. So the key to cleaning up your neighborhood is communication with the people that live there. No matter who they are, the community as a whole can clean up, drugs and all. I agree with Mr. Mitchell on one thing. When we talk to the police and we say, you know, the drug house down the street, so and so. Yes, the police know where the drug houses are, but they cannot, I wish they could, they cannot go in and just knock it down and put everybody in jail. It doesn't work that way. So we have to keep fighting and calling and discussing with each other.
Thank you very much. Last question from the moderator to the panel before we turn it over to the public, and I'll explain a little bit how we're going to try to alternate between questions that have been put up here and the Mac mic. We're going to try to go back and forth. But last question, and if we could spend maybe 2 minutes max, 2-3 minutes max on this. Again, from our youth representative, beautiful Dillard, if you could snap your fingers today and have your college degree, a job, a spouse, a family today, and you could live anywhere in Dallas you wanted to today, would you live in the neighborhood you live in now, or would you live somewhere else, and why?
People there with their negativity and their values, and it really doesn't matter where you live, as long as you have your perspective and you know what you're gonna do, and and it really doesn't matter where you grow up, as long as you stay focused and pay attention and at least learn from other people and get advice and.
great answer. Thank you very much. Now, let's give our panel a round of applause.